Who's up? Who's down?
All right, Andrew, over 100 episodes. Who is your first 100th who's up?
My who's up is Tom Brady. Now, this is going to be one of the topics later. I could have gone Peyton Manning, could have gone Tony Romo, could have gone Greg Olsen, who I think Greg Olsen actually is the leader in terms of my most who's ups. But I'm going to go Tom Brady because I think he shows how big the sports media game has become, not only because of his 10-year, $375 million contract, but he's considered the greatest football player of all time, and he's going to be in the broadcast booth. Wait, what does the Brady meter say? Uh-oh, Brady meter. Brady meter, 50-50. All right, Brady meter's at 50-50. We'll leave it there.
No change on the Brady meter. No change.
Well, it was 51-49, and that was the last time we said this caused some issues. But Tom Brady, I think, is just emblematic of how big this topic has become, if it's college football, if it's the regional sports networks. But he's considered the greatest football player of all time, and then he's next going to be in the broadcast booth in a year. And we've seen so many ramifications for what is going on, especially in the NFL booths, but just all over the place with the NBA booths, baseball, everywhere. A lot of change over the last 100 episodes. And I think Tom Brady signing with Fox Sports, though, was the biggest and most important. And if he ends up doing it, will be the biggest topic a year from now.
My who's up, Andrew, is Marie Donahue, who is the top executive for Amazon. And this is why. When they went to get the Thursday Night Football package, it was a package that every single TV network passed on. So it looked like it was destined to fail. The viewership was certain to be low. The production quality was good. The viewership was low, but that was to be expected. But they proved that they could amass a big audience and not have everything crash. And so I think by all respects, Thursday Night Football on Amazon has been a resounding success, and that was not certain when we started this pod 100 episodes ago. So congratulations to Marie and to Amazon on that. Once they got the NFL and once they found success with the NFL, look, this is the Jeff Bezos company. They have the deepest pockets that are out there. So I thought that they would start spending money indiscriminately just to keep getting sports rights. And what I've seen is that they've been very disciplined, much more disciplined than I ever would have expected in terms of where they're going to put their money and what kind of packages that they want. So they're not trying to build an ESPN Plus or even become a worldwide leader in sports on digital. They're being very methodical and getting packages that make sense for Amazon, and their strategy is coming through. We can see it now, and I think over the last 100 weeks, it has been a resounding success for Marie and for Amazon.
All right, my who's down are the ESPN direct-to-consumer naysayers. One of the big things we started talking about this right from the beginning is when will ESPN, the whole enchilada, go direct-to-consumer? I said it then, it would be within 5 years. It's going to be within 5 years. Not going to be next year, unlikely. 2025, very possible. It will happen by 26. I think anybody who doubted that ESPN was going direct to consumer is going to be proven wrong. Now, things do change, but you could just see the trends this week. The NFL with NFL Network brought it direct to consumer. We've seen it in the regional sports networks. They've gone mostly direct to consumer, at least offering that product. And here's another prediction. When ESPN goes direct to consumer, I don't think it's going to have as big an impact over the cable bundle, which is, of course, going down and will continue to until it probably plateaus around 50 million. But that said, it's happening. So my who's down is all the ESPN direct to consumer naysayers, because if people listen to this, we've been talking about this subject and writing about it for a long time. I know it's become very popular in recent months, but the ESPN direct to consumer naysayers will be proven wrong. And by 2026, ESPN will have a product where you don't need cable, which will be a huge thing, but I don't think it will be as groundbreaking in terms of changing the business. I think the business will already be changing at that point, even without it.
Andrew, mine is down, no surprise at all. At the Super Bowl in Arizona, I was walking out of the press room And this guy came up to me and showed me his fantasy football team name was Who's Down Chris Ripley. And he said he was the only one in his league that understood it, but he thought it was funny. So that's what he made the name Chris Ripley of Sinclair. The obvious choice for Who's Down over the first 100 episodes. We're going to talk about the RSN implosion. That's one of the topics that is coming up. But it's an implosion that didn't have to be this quick and this violent. If you look at the NBC sports, regional sports networks, they're still profitable. They're not as profitable as they used to be, but they're still profitable. If you look at YES Network or what's happening in Los Angeles with the Dodgers and the Lakers networks or NESN, even Masson, which has had a couple of tough headlines over the past couple of weeks, that's still a profitable network. Sinclair, used to run the Bally Sports networks, you know, they mismanaged those networks. They mismanaged the relationships. We already taped our interview with Brett Yormark, and one of the things he talks about is how he's a relationship guy. You hear that in the sports and media business all the time. Chris Ripley mismanaged every relationship with big people who matter, like Rob Manfred and with the NBA. There was no reason why those RSNs had to drop as far and as fast as they did. And over the first 100 episodes, I think that's a pretty clear call.
No, 100%. If you didn't do Chris Ripley, there would have been a riot about the pod, because obviously Who's Down. And that's great. That fantasy football name. And if we inspire any other fantasy, why didn't you tell that story earlier? That's a tremendous story.
Well, you know, I was waiting to get the guy's name. I wanted to give him an actual shout out. And I never got his name, and we never followed up on it. So if you're listening to this, let me know, because I love that name.